So I begin from where we left in Rollabar's essay, The Death of the Author. So in the last class we discussed how Barthes proposes the reading of texts which would be anti-theological in the sense that God and his hypostasis, reason, science and law, these will not be looked into or sought in a text. So no other metaphysical consideration beyond the text itself should be the concern of reading. Let us come back to the Balzac sentence. No one, no person says it, its source, its voice is not the true place of the writing, which is reading. So no person or no voice is the true place of writing. What is the true place of writing? It is reading. So reading is the true place of writing. In other words, the activity of reading makes writing what it is, makes writing writing. To make this clear, Barthes gives an example. J.P. Vernon, a French mythologist, we should say, he wrote books on Greek mythology. Vernon has demonstrated the constitutively ambiguous nature of Greek tragedy, its text being woven from words with double meanings that each character understands unilaterally. This perpetual misunderstanding is exactly the tragic. So Vernon looks at certain Greek words in Greek tragedy, and a particular word can be interpreted in two ways. For example, Derrida's famous example, the Greek word pharmakos means both medicine and poison, on the basis of which Derrida says that one can deconstruct the meaning. If anything can mean something as well as its opposite, then one may suggest that the meaning may be the opposite of what is conventionally understood. The theory of deconstruction more or less is based on such an idea. Vernon said that some Greek words in Greek tragedy could be interpreted in different ways, and different characters in a tragedy interpret the words in different ways, leading to tragic consequences. And this is also a rhetorical figure. When a word is meant ambiguously in such a fashion that its opposite meaning is also possible, it is called antiphrasis. There is, however, someone who understands each word in its duplicity and who in addition hears the very deafness of the characters speaking in front of him, this someone being precisely the reader. So the reader or the audience of the tragedy understand both the meanings of the disputed word, and therefore the reader can also see how characters are making mistakes on the stage because of the different understanding of the word. And therefore to the reader, the whole irony of the tragic situation is revealed. So precisely the reader or the listener in the case of a dramatic performance, thus is revealed the total existence of writing. A text is made of multiple writings drawn from many cultures and entering into mutual relations of dialogue, parody, contestation, but there is one place where this multiplicity is focused, and that place is the reader. not as was hitherto said the author. So Barth uses the analysis of Greek plays by J.P. Varno to support his argument that the reader makes writing comprehensible or gives writing its true meaning. The reader is the space on which all the quotations that make up writing are inscribed without any of them being lost. So we see here also the Barthesian idea of intertextuality, the idea which was proposed by Rolla Barthes and Julia Kristeva. Because here you see Barthes talks about multiple writings drawn from many cultures and entering into mutual relations of dialogue, parody, contestation, and so on. Now, whereas we may today look at intertextuality from a postmodern point of view, taught by Barthes and Kristeva, we understand intertextuality today in a particular way. But it is not that intertextuality was absent in a text before Barthes or Kristeva spoke about it, because all texts are by nature intertextual. And we have many great examples. For example, you think of T.S. Eliot's The Wasteland. So many different strands of culture, literature, poetry, all have been absorbed into that poem. But Eliot is a modernist poet, but that did not stop him from writing an intertextual text. But nobody could properly interpret the text with the theory of intertextuality, which had to wait till Barthes and Kristeva gave us this analytical tool of intertextuality, or the theory of intertextuality. So the reader is the space where all quotations make up a writing, that make up a writing are inscribed without any of them being lost. A text's unity lies not in its origin, but in its destination. So if the origin is the author, the destination is the reader. So the text's meaning or the text's unity lies in the destination, that is the reader. So why does the question of unity arise? Because if a text is intertextual, now notice that Barthes never uses the word intertextual or intertextuality in this theory. Because Barthes is not like me, who has recently learned a term and loves to use it again and again. So most of us are like that. Whenever we learn any critical jargon or any critical term, we love to use it. But he never uses the term intertextuality, even though he is talking about it. In the last year, I made your senior batch do a whole seminar on intertextuality in this essay. All right. So they worked very hard on this essay and traced each and every author that Barthes mentions here. And I assigned each of the students or the groups one of those authors or texts just to look at the intertextuality of this essay. Yet this destination cannot any longer be personal. The reader is without history, biography, psychology. So even though the destination of a text is the reader, it is not person-oriented study of a text, like the when we looked at the origin of a text as the author, we read the author's biography, we tried to know personal things about the author and tried to interpret his work by in the light of those facts. So that was a person-oriented attempt at interpretation. But here it is not like that, because we are not interested in the reader as a person. So the reader here serves as a space. Therefore, he is without history, biography, psychology. He is simply that someone who holds together in a single field all the traces by which the written text is constituted. Now, here is another word, or a new term, or a jargon, trace. This word is used by postmodernist writers. Barth, Derrida, they talk about trace. So, the idea is that a writer writes something, then he disappears, but he leaves a trace, and we can only look at the trace. So all the traces left by all the different authors and writers whose texts are used intertextually in a particular work, the reader focuses on all those traces. So the idea of the trace is important to postmodernism, because a trace is without origin. There could be some origin, but one has lost the origin and only the trace is left. Okay, so we say something to be a trace when we cannot trace its originator. Okay, so after the murderer has committed murder and left, the police is called to seek the traces, isn't it? So then they do a kind of backward deduction and try to reach at the origin of those traces, which is the plot structure of any detective story. So trace means that there is no origin to be found, which is why it is derisory to condemn the new writing in the name of a humanism, hypocritically turned champion of the reader's rights. No, I do not know who Barth has in mind, not the Anglo-Saxon reader's response theory, but maybe some French writer that he is challenging here. So Barth says that it is not like people are crying horse today for the rights of the reader. It is no use, Barth says, to raise the bogey of humanism and to cry for the rights of a reader. That would be hypocritical. Classic criticism has never paid any attention to the reader. For it, the writer is the only person in literature. We are now beginning to let ourselves be fooled no longer by the arrogant, antifrastical recrimination of good society in favor of the very thing it sets aside, ignores, smothers, or destroys. Very interesting sentence. So, J.P. Varno says that in tragedy, antiphrasis is used, a word which has a completely different meaning, and that leads to the tragic, in the tragedy. So, I am trying to explain Barth to you, and you understand just the opposite of what I am saying. So that would be tragic, according to J.P. Varno. Alright. So tragedy means that you understand something completely different. But I am not using antiphrasis, so that there is no scope of understanding me differently. Barth uses the same concept here with reference to the process of interpretation of literature, the very thing that society sets aside. So in writing, it sets aside the reader, and the different meanings or the different hypostasis of God which the society pursues and sets aside other meanings which could be derived from texts. the criticism that Barth proposes, that would be a removal of this kind of arrogance, which ignores, smothers, destroys, sets aside the possible meanings and imposes a conventionally accepted author-oriented meaning to particular texts. And this process Barth calls an arrogant recrimination. Why? Because it sets aside the various other possible meanings. And Barth says that we are not going to be fooled any longer by such arrogant recriminations. And who are these arrogant people? The traditional critics who set aside violently and refuse to accept that there could be other meanings of text. We know that to give writing its future, it is necessary to overthrow the myth. Which myth? The myth of the author. The author is a myth which Barth decodes, destroys, brings down from the pedestal and overthrows. The birth of the reader must be at the cost of the death of the author. So in order to arrive at interpretation of texts properly, we have to pay a price, that is the death of the author. So unless you bring down the author from his pedestal and allow text to be interpreted in multiple ways by making the reader the space where various meanings converge, where the traces of multiple intertextual texts converge, you won't be able to arrive at a true meaning. Therefore, the whole argument of this essay is that one must reject the author-centered interpretation of texts, or the idea that the author's intended meaning is the true meaning of a text. On the other hand, one must give value to all the other multiple traces of multiple writers which have been evoked by the author in the creation of a text, and interpret the text by bringing into focus those other meanings which the author-centered interpretation suppressed. So one may say that this essay is one step away from deconstruction, because the purpose of Derrida's deconstruction theory was to further destroy the author-centric meaning of any text by suggesting that the meaning of a text could be just the opposite of what its accepted meaning is, or what one understands to be the author's meaning. Right. So, in this way we see this essay may be called, first, it is post-structuralist because some of its assumptions are on the basis of structuralism and the Saussurean linguistics, the idea of the sign as a signifier and the meaning as signified. But the essay, in a very creative manner, goes on to point out how the tradition of empiricism, rationalism, these traditions gradually failed to produce any proper meaning to text. For example, any biography-oriented attempt at interpretation always appears to be limited. Van Gogh's works are interpreted by his madness. Baudelaire's works are interpreted by the failure of the man Baudelaire. Tchaikovsky's works by his vices. So these are absolute failures in terms of interpretation, or at most very partial interpretations of the author's works. Therefore, author-oriented interpretations are of no good. Their explanations are always very narrow. And then Barth traces the origin of his idea of the reader as the center of interpretation in such past French writers like Mallarmé and Valéry, who also suggested that the reader gives meaning to a poem. From Proust, Barth argues that in Proust we see art, life imitating art, then art imitating life. So a kind of an inversion of mimesis in Proust's work. In the surrealist tradition, he sees the destruction of all metaphysical value of the author, because they spoke of automatic writing, they spoke of joint writing by a number of authors and so on. And then by using the linguistic theory of Jale Austin, the speech act theory, Barth says that the author's function is nothing more than declaring something to be open, like one inaugurates an event and says that I declare it open. So basically the author becomes a cipher, and there is no single theological meaning or a single message of the author. Okay. And then he gives the examples of De Quincey, the example of Buber and Pécuchet, all these examples of the attempt of creating something by bringing together tissues of writings from other authors, other texts. So Barth's idea that any text is a kind of a pastiche, a kind of a collage where tissues taken from various sources are woven together. And basically the rejection of the voice of the author, because a voice means presence. So the author is not metaphysically present in his text. It would be wrong to assume that the author is present in his text, because what we are left with is only traces. So the author is nowhere to be seen. Therefore, the unity to a text is given not by an author, but by the reader, who can follow all these traces and arrive at particular meaning of any text. So I finished the discussion of the text. Now we'll look at the questions. So as I can see that the questions are very simple. How does Roll of Earth trace the evolution of the author function in Mallarmé, Valéry and Proust? Now here in this question I am using this phrase author function kind of unhistorically, because this phrase was invented by Michel Foucault, who wrote after this. And actually if you read Foucault's essay What is an Author, after reading this essay, then you will understand how this postmodern attempt at making the process of reading more and more reader oriented and less theological. So you just have to follow the essay, talk about Mallarmé, Valéry and Proust, and to show how in the works of these writers the importance of the author was not that much, because Mallarmé said that the reader gives a meaning to his work, to his poems. He suppresses the author in the interest of writing. Valéry was more classical in attitude. He militated in favor of the essentially verbal condition of literature. So that means looking at a literary text more as a linguistic work, where language is at play, rather than an author-centric interpretation of a work. What does Barthes mean by saying it is language which speaks and not the author? We may say that this statement depends on the linguistic school of criticism. Modern linguistics has focused on the way language works. And for example, in Chomsky linguistics, we see that there is the talk of deep structure. Every language works in a particular way. And if we think of the linguistic theory of Ferdinand de Saussure, that every word is a sign and every sign has a signifier and a signified, but the signified does not remain the same for a sign. With every use, a sign has a different signifier, and therefore one may say of a chain of signifiers in language. So language has its own way of speaking, and in a text, when one looks at a text linguistically or looks at its structure, one does not find the author at all. The structuralist analysis of texts gives us examples how the structuralist critics, they have nothing to say about the author, because the author is not there in the text. So the structuralist critic would look at particular signs or particular signifiers which are being used in the text with particular meanings or particular signified, and would look at a text by creating certain paradigms. Paradigmatic and syntagmatic axis, on these two axes, a structuralist critic would select certain signs from the text, and how these signs are related on these axes according to the different paradigms. That is the pursuit of a structuralist critic. So whether we look at a text from a structuralist point of view or a linguistic point of view, there is no concern for the author in such analysis. And therefore, if Barthes makes language to be a primary concern in his essay, then we would say that this essay is built on the foundation of linguistic criticism and structuralism, but it goes beyond structuralism. It is a post-structuralist in the sense that it uses the insights of structuralism, but in itself this essay is not written in the manner of a structural is brighter. The essay itself is a piece of deliberation which is imbued with post-structural understanding of language, but it is itself, in itself, it is not a structuralist piece of writing. So Barthes wrote as a structuralist, and in that phase of his writing, the best example is the textual analysis post Valdemar, which is selected in this selection by David Lodge. If you are interested in knowing what is structuralist analysis, then you look at this essay, you see how the whole text of Valdemar is broken into shorter pieces, which Barthes calls lexias. And then in each of these lexias, he looks for certain paradigms, certain symbols. So this is one example of structuralist criticism. Another great example is SZ by Barthes. In that book, he discusses Balzac's novella Sarrazine. Okay. So by the time Barthes came to write this essay, he crossed the structuralist phase, and in mythologies he was using a lot of semiotics. So we may say that the semiotic phase lasted from more or less 1957 to 1977, image music text. And there is this influential essay by Barthes, Introduction to the Structuralist Analysis of Narrative, in 1966, which is included in image music text. But this essay comes after that, in 1968, the death of the author essay. And here it is, we may say, post-structuralist, because by this time thinking has developed. However, after this essay, he writes SZ in 1970, just 2 years after this essay, and then, yes. So SZ is a book, also the textual analysis of a tale by Poe, 1973. In these two books, Barthes uses structuralist narratology. So we cannot speak of exact chronology in Barthes' literary oeuvre. So even after formulating the death of the essay, he went on to use structuralist narratology in his two works. But then after that, again, he writes very different kind of things in The Pleasure of the Text and Rolla Barthes by Rolla Barthes. So as I told you earlier, that Barthes reinvented his style every time and moved on. But definitely when Barthes was writing The Death of the Author, then his ideas, many ideas in this essay, are post-structuralist as well as post-modern. What do the terms enunciation and performative mean in Death of the Author? So I don't suppose, well, these are short questions. Why am I looking at short questions? So let me look at the long questions. Would you call Barthes, the death of the author, a postmodernist essay? Justify your answer. Okay. So I do not know whether this question will come, but yes. This essay is a postmodernist essay because the term postmodernism supposes that the attempt at arriving at a particular meaning is denied in postmodern frame of mind. So whether it is Barthes, the death of the author, or Derrida's writings, deconstruction theory, this understanding of final meaning in postmodern writing is completely absent. So I will briefly take you to the site of postmodernism so that very briefly you can have an overview. I have a synopsis of postmodernism, but I have to find out that paper where I kept it. So for the time being, let us look at postmodernism. It is a broad movement that developed in the mid to late 20th century across philosophy, the arts, architecture and criticism, marking a departure from modernism. The term has been more generally applied to describe a historical era said to follow after modernity and the tendencies of this era. Now this is not completely satisfactory because there is an essay which says that the term, the prefix post in postmodernism is not, it does not mean after. So it means different from modernism. So it is not exactly the way post is used in other words. It is generally defined by an attitude of skepticism, irony or rejection toward what it describes as the grand narrative and ideology associated with modernism, enlightenment, rationality, and focusing on the ideology of maintaining political or economic power. So in postmodernism, one talks about a rejection of objective reality, morality, truth, human nature, reason, science, language, social progress, and so on. In other words, it rejects any kind of meta-narrative, and it talks about self-referentiality, self-consciousness, epistemological and moral relativism, pluralism, and irreverence. So we will see how these skeptical ideas, and in general a total rejection of enlightenment theory, a rejection of rationalism, and a very nihilistic attitude towards life in general can be seen in postmodernist theory. And in this essay we find that by rejecting the author-centric interpretation of a text, Barthes is rejecting a theology of the text or a final meaning of the text, which is in consonance with any postmodernist idea. In deconstruction theory, Derrida talks about a permanent deferral of meaning. So there is no final meaning to any text. So if a text does not have any author-given meaning, and every reader creates a meaning of his or her own, then a text is an open-ended text. It cannot be a closed text. And a text is plural. Its meanings are plural. It cannot have one meaning. Therefore, this extreme relativity and complete skepticism, these are features of a postmodern approach. Okay. So I will later tell you the other qualities of postmodernism when I find that piece of paper where I jotted down. But basically, it means a rejection of any metaphysical meaning or what today critics call meta-narrative, that is, any larger philosophical frame in which all particulars can be included and can be interpreted. So such meta-narratives are completely rejected. We also use the term grand theory. So a grand theory of history, for example, we find in Hegel and Karl Marx, a dialectical historical materialism. So all such grand theories or meta-narratives, those are rejected in the postmodern approach. Why does Barthes speak of a theology of the author as the meaning giver to his work? Why does he suggest that the theology needs to be discarded? So, theology, this word is used with reference to this essay because it is used by comparing a text with the world. So, as God is the creator of the world, or God is believed or was believed to be the creator of the world, so in that view of the world, there is the creator and his creation. So that is a theological view of the world. Similarly, if we believe that an author is the creator of his work, then we have the creator and his creation. That is why, metaphorically, Barthes speaks of a theology of the author, which presupposes that every work has an origin. And the task of the critic is to look for the origin, that is, what is the intended meaning of the author, which Barthes calls deciphering of meaning. So a critic must investigate to decipher the meaning of the author's text to understand what the author originally intended. But if we believe that a text does not have any particular author given meaning, because a text is not one particular entity, but it is a weaving of a great number of tissues taken from different works, different authors, then a text becomes a multiple composite or a kind of a pastiche, and it contains traces of multiple authors or multiple ideas. And in that case, there cannot be one author given meaning to such a text. So Barthes rejects this idea and says that the site of meaning, the site of production of meaning of a text is the reader. The theology, why should the theology be discarded? Because philosophically, post-Nietzsche, the existence of God is no longer tenable. So, with the disappearance of the God term, all referentiality becomes impossible. Because everything would have a definite meaning and a definite place in the universe as long as one believed in the ultimate referential point, which was God. But when that ultimate point of reference is no longer there, then all meaning collapses. Therefore, it would be arbitrary now to have a view that an author may be the origin of meaning of his work, because no meaning is possible as there is no final reference point. How does dissolution of the author function open up the text for multiple interpretations? Discuss with reference to the author poet cited by Barthes to explain this evolution of writing. So here you have to talk about the authors like Mallarmé, Valéry, Proust, and so on, used by Barthes to exemplify how the author function tends to disappear, and then how Barthes also uses the speech act theory of J.L. Austin, the Oxford philosopher, who talks about performative aspect of language, a rare verbal form of performative, which does not mean anything beyond the performance. A rare verbal form exclusively given in the first person and in the present tense, in which the enunciation has no other content than the act by which it is uttered. So enunciation is a linguistic concept, which means articulation, oral articulation of a particular linguistic structure or a sentence. And Austin said that in an enunciation, in an oral statement, where the verb does not have any other meaning beyond its content, there it becomes a performative statement, like I declare of the kings or I sing of the ancient poets. So it is the act of declaring or the act of singing which is being referred to by these phrases, I declare or I sing, and they do not have any other meaning beyond that. So these are performative, that refers to the performance, the actual act of declaring or singing. So Austin calls it speech act, and Barthes uses the example of that to suggest that the writing by an author is like that. So the author can just declare his work to be open, because basically he cannot give his work any other meaning. He has to wait for the readers to give it a meaning. Right. So the author's act is more of a gesture, a symbolic gesture, rather than devolving any meaning onto the text. Rolover's discovery of uncertainty of meaning in Barthes' Sarrazin opens up the whole discussion of the disappearance of the author in the essay, the death of the author, comment on Barthes' method of criticism. So Barthes begins with Sarrazin, and in the middle of the essay again comes back to Sarrazin, and to one sentence from Sarrazin, where in this sentence it is not clear who is the speaker, and the sentence attempts to give us the idea of womanhood, but without knowing who is the speaker, all these ideas seem to float uncertainly. Since traditionally we associate meaning with the author, therefore here by reading this sentence, we would normally try to understand the sentence by associating it with its speaker. But Balzac keeps it ambiguous. Who is the speaker of this sentence? Whether it is Balzac, the individual, or Balzac, the author, or is it some kind of universal statement of romantic psychology and so on and so forth? So keeping the speaker ambiguous makes this sentence an assembly of codes which cannot be deciphered. So deciphering something means that you understand the author's meaning. But when you cannot decipher something, then these words are to be, these signs are to be looked upon as codes, and then you may perhaps employ structuralist theory to decode them. Which means that you completely ignore the author. So this sentence is Barthes' example that language hangs precariously without an author, without a voice, without the presence of a person, and in that case this language has to be treated linguistically. This language must be understood linguistically, not with reference to any author or speaker. And when we try to understand language linguistically, then we look for the codes of the language, we try to make a structuralist or linguistic analysis of that language. Then we look at language as a text that is not defined by its author or not interpreted as the author understood. The birth of the reader must be at the cost of the death of the author. Does birth suggest the development of a reader-oriented person? Okay. So what do you say? Is it a reader-oriented criticism? Yes, of course. So if we think of the author as an origin and the reader as a destination, then meaning is produced at the destination of the text, which means the reader. So the reader gives meaning to the text, therefore it is a reader-oriented criticism. There is no doubt about that. But the interesting formulation that the birth of the reader should be at the cost of the death of the author. So as long as we believed in author-centric criticism, was there no reader? So why the reader has to be born today? So obviously by reader, Barthes does not mean anybody who just reads the text, but Barthes means anybody who makes an attempt to interpret the text, to break down the text, to look at the codes contained in the text, to make a structuralist analysis of the text. So Barthes' reader is not just a reader who reads for enjoyment, but a critic. And not a traditional critic, but a new kind of critic, a critic who uses the linguistics of Ferdinand de Saussure, who uses structuralism, who uses semiotics, who uses narratology. So all these developments which have been possible because of Saussurean linguistics, semiotics, narratology, structuralist analysis. Therefore a reader who is also a critic would produce some kind of an interpretation, and this reader can be born only when the author-centric metaphysical theory is discarded. That is why Barthes says that the worth of the reader must be at the cost of the author. How it looks forward to Foucault's What is an Author? This question will not come, but I ask this question to push you towards reading Foucault's What is an Author. So this question can only come if you have in syllabus both the essays. Do you have both the essays in your syllabus? No. So you are exempted from answering this question. Alright, so now I have talked at length on Barthes. If you have any questions, you ask me now.